So today I wanted to play a little bit with the self-siphoning beads. Now I've done this a little bit before, just kind of seeing that it worked because I saw this cool video on the internet. And then I had to try it myself. And so I did. Now, it got me to thinking about what are the physics of this, because it's really kind of a bizarre thing. And I found a post online that seemed to explain it, but it wasn't really very satisfying. So I wanted to collect some of my own data. So let's take a look here. What I have set up right now is two vernier dual range force sensors and a LabQuest. The LabQuest is interfaced with my iPad so I can collect the data. I know, got to use some more technology. And so I can actually then analyze what I'm looking at, because I have no idea what I'm going to see. So let's see if we can get this started. What we're going to do, get this ready up here, and hopefully everything lines up perfectly. This is the hard part. Then we start the data collecting. Data is collecting. And then we cross our fingers. Looks like we got some data. All right, so here's our data, such as they are. Not sure exactly what they tell us yet, but let's see if we can figure some things out and maybe we can learn something. I have no idea. So what we have is we have this nice line for our top sensor and this nice line for our bottom sensor. Now, they're kind of inverted just because of the nature of the way the sensors work, and I didn't feel like trying to change them up somehow. So the top sensor shows in this graph that it's gaining weight, but it's actually losing weight, and vice versa for the bottom sensor. But that's okay, that's neither here nor there. Now, this last piece here shows this is where the final bit of chain was out of the glass. And unfortunately, I don't have the final bit at the end of the bottom sensor, but that's okay. I still think we can learn some things from these data. And then we see some other weird things, like this weird set of spikes here. This is probably a weird loop that hit the side of the beaker, which slowed it down for a moment, and then we get some weird sort of weirdness after that. But it's not that bad. We can still see the general trend. And if I highlight a piece of it here, we can see that it is more or less linear. And the slopes of both of the lines are very similar, as you would expect. Now, the interesting thing that I didn't expect when I started this whole thing was that it's a very constant rate once it gets started. I assumed it would accelerate the whole time. In my mind, I pictured this as an Atwood's machine, where as the chain comes up out of the glass, we have a kind of a small weight, and then on the other side we have kind of a big weight because we have a longer chain. And we had basically a frictionless pulley in that floating loop. I thought this was a perfect example of a frictionless pulley Atwood's machine, but that would mean it would accelerate the entire time, and it doesn't do that. In fact, it really seems to only accelerate at the beginning. Let me get this out of our way for a second and zoom in here. So if we were to select this piece here and find our relationship, if I do a linear, I'm going to end up with a very different slope than I had for the main portion. And you'll see here that the slope is about half a newton per second. And on the other section, it was closer to 0.8 newtons per second. So a very different relationship. So I'm going to change that into what's probably more likely a quadratic or some sort of, I'm not sure if it's a quadratic or maybe it's a cubic. I have no idea. But we can see that we get a nice fit now. And in fact, if I were to zoom out and have this fit along with the linear fit, so let's actually pull this back because we can see this is when it hits the bottom, and this is probably where it starts. That's probably where I let go. All right, let's zoom out. Woo! There we go. There's a nice zoom. Let's double tap to auto zoom. Come on. There we go. Now, if I highlight again and do our linear piece, it should hopefully line up kind of nicely with our quadratic piece at the beginning. And you can see that it ends up being a very similar sort of look, where the slopes end up being about the same. So it's as if as soon as it gets to the bottom, it stops accelerating. That's kind of cool, because we can see when it gets to the bottom, because we get this huge spike here in our bottom sensor. And we can see we've got this nice even curve, and then we continue on at that nice exactly same slope as it got to a constant. Really cool, but why does it do that? That I still don't know, and I'm still trying to figure out. So let's look at some other things that I've kind of figured out along the way. This loop doesn't form until the chain gets to the bottom. That is to say, it's accelerating, and as soon as it stops accelerating, that loop forms because the chain's gotten to the bottom. Kind of cool. Another thing, the higher up this jar is from the floor, the bigger the loop gets. I did this from, like, I don't know, 20 feet, and it got really big. I wish I had a camera set up to take a picture, but I didn't. And again, even at that height, the loop didn't form until the chain got to the bottom. I had spotters at the bottom to tell me when it got to the bottom. So where does that leave things? I wish I knew. So if we here's the data. If we look, we can see that the slope of the down one is greater than the slope of the top sensor. Is this because the bottom sensor is putting more of a normal force up? Is that what pushes the beads upwards? I don't know. It's not like a stick. So I took some pictures, because I don't have a high-speed enough camera, so I took some still pictures because I had a thought. I'm like, what if the beads were slightly compressed on the way down as opposed to the way up? And I could discern no real difference. But how much compression would there have to be? Because in my mind, I'm thinking, well, if we think about mass per unit length, if the beads are more stretched out, then we have less mass per unit length than if they're squished together. And so maybe the beads on the way up are going faster, each individual bead is going faster on the way up than it is on the way down. Maybe that's why we get our slightly higher loop, but the momentum is the same on the way up and the way down for any individual bead section of beads. I don't know. I have no idea, and I don't know how else to get there, because it's a very, I don't have the models to be able to do this. So where do we go from here? I don't know. But I think it has something to do with the beads on the downside being slightly compressed, but I don't know that, and I don't even know how much compressed they would have to be in order to get this loop. It's really a fun problem, and you know what? I'm sorry that you watched this whole video, and I don't have any answers for you. I wish I did.